Can you explain what is the beginning of this and the meaning of this extraordinary place?
Oh, actually, I dreamed this place when I was 20 years old. You know, like before I was actually I myself a frustrated artist because I used to learning Balinese art from my neighbors as a villagers. Most of the villagers, children, young people, they always learning painting, carving, they learn dance, they learn music because that is part of the tradition here. And I'm not very good in that, you know. So I become a street peddler where I sell my friends' work to backpackers I met on the street. I met in Kuta, I met in Sano. I hustling many Australian people who are people which I met it, on the beach, you know. So I always making money and always, you know, we share with the painters around this area in Ubud, because in that time I think it's not easy to sell Balinese art. And I did that for almost from 70 to 78. In the same time I picked my English, because my father is a farmer, he can afford to send me to school, you know. So, you know, I'm more learning by doing, yeah. Or I work very hard and learning by doing, selling Balinese art, you know, for almost 8 years, from 1970 to 78. And then I start thinking about to establish a gallery. Then we have Agung Rai gallery. So there were many children interested to learn Balinese art, you know. I always provided the material. And any children after school, they always come to Agung Rai galleries. The first gallery established it in 1978. Since then, you know, I promoted Balinese art overseas, in Australia, in Japan, in Europe, in, you know, United States, because I think it's important to promote it. Marketing, promote it more and more, also publishing books. And I always, the exhibition always success. And then, you know, the same time I found very ancient Balinese art overseas, you know, in Holland, in Germany, yeah, in United States, in New York. So, oh my God, so I don't have it in Bali. I believe that during the Dutch time, they took it out by the Dutch, and I heard that what I read from the book, in 1931, those pieces was exhibited in Paris at the Exposition de la Paris. So that pieces of Balinese art is spread all over in Europe or United States. So I start collecting the ancient Balinese art beside Kamasan, the earlier form of the Ubud style, because they were, you know, like flowers and bees among the Balinese artists, and there were many foreigners artists moved to Bali and live here after World War I, like Spies, Bonnets, you know, Roland Strauss or Theo Meyer from Switzerland. I think they were like very interesting in direction, and whatever produced by Balinese in that time, then they exhibited in Paris in 1931. So because we have so many, you know, so many, I'm start thinking how to, I don't want to sell it, because those pieces become part of my spirit, like my children, you know. I don't want to sell it. So I'm thinking about to house it. So I dream to have this place, so I start buying piece of land, you know. You know, it took me about 15 years to buy this property, because I'm thinking about to have not just a museum, but a living museum. You know what I mean? Because this collection has related with the nature, has related with the people here, and related with the daily activities, with the ritual, with the celebration here. So it is, to me, is a living museum. That's what I dream it. When I try to combine it, the art made by men with the art given by nature. And that is the uniqueness of this place. And then of course, you know, I'm thinking about how to bring our people. I'm sure this is not easy job to bring locally people to the museum. I don't want only visitor. Besides visitor, I think locally people is so important to see their culture here or the development here. So I'm start thinking about to work with the school, so children. So we open here in ARMA also free courses after school. Children, any children are welcome to learning dance, to learning music, to learning painting, wood carving and sculpture, learning as well, learning batik. It's free of charge after school time because I believe those children are our future who will continue this tradition here, who will continue the uniqueness of those cultures here. So in 1996, the dreams come true. The dreams come true. It was opened for public, inaugurated by the Minister of Culture and Education from Indonesia, from Jakarta, Professor Dr. Engineer Wadi Manjoyo Negoro. It was in 1996. But and then I was thinking about how to keep this concept sustainable, you know. You know, then I begin thinking about to have this ARMA Resort. It's not only a museum. Actually, my idea was to bring in into the museum the Balinese architecture, the Balinese compound to the museum. But people start thinking about, oh, this is resort, but they forgot. Actually, my idea was to bring in Balinese architecture to the museum. So then people are interested to stay here because it's so beautiful. Of course, you know, we don't want it too many room because my idea also, the rice field, we keep it. We don't want to touch it. Because this is, I think, it has strongly connection with the Balinese art as the source of the inspiration. Where also for our children, they could see every day the history of the rice they eat. Every day. They work, the farmer work very hard. They really work with the cows, you know, to flowering everything by hand, the ecosystem, the water, the irrigation. Actually what I had, this system already existed 300 before common era. So this is, we have to respect it. We have to keep it, we have to preserve it. That's why the rice field around this area is part of the ARMA Museum. So nobody could develop it, you know, because always here. That is actually my idea. I think I'm very grateful to my wife who really support me. Until now, I never, not even a night, I never stay here. This is a really, my idea was, it's a cross-subsiding. People who are staying in ARMA Resort, they can see where the money go, 100%. Transparent, accountability, they can see it. Their contribution, and they also fertilizing our tradition here.